David Amram. Thank you so much. I was going to play the keyboard, but there's no keyboard here. However, one of the hallmarks of our era, being a young fellow of 82, our era was during the Depression, where no one had expectations of doing anything, so whatever you tried to do, you just did anyway, with no expectations of anything except hopefully being able to do it. So if I can borrow that person's guitar, even though I'm not a guitar player, I'll play that, and share a little piece with you. But I wanted to tell you very briefly the interesting beginnings of Allen doing that recording. In the fall of 1971, I was living on 6th Avenue and 11th Street, and Bob Dylan called up and said, Gregory and Allen are giving a reading at NYU. Do you want to come down? It was a few blocks from where Bob lived and where I lived. So we went down. And Allen was going through the new phase that year. He had this gigantic white smock and his little harmonium and was singing, which I thought was great. I'd never heard him do that except at parties. And Gregory was being Gregory. And in the second half, we went back. And Alice said, David, he said, tell him to come to my apartment. I've been trying to get him to come for 10 years. 10 years. Please get him to come over. I said, well, I can ask him. So I said to Bob, you want to come over and see Alan? And with his usual enthusiasm, he said, yeah, why not? So we went to Nathan's, which was the place where you could get fried clams and hot dogs and had a good health, high cholesterol, death dinner. Went by Alice, walked up to his place. Allen opened up the door. He had a guitar, which he handed to Bob. He had his harmonium, and he said, G, Bob, the key of G. Then he played a B natural on his harmonium, and he had a tape recorder right in the hallway, and he pushed down the button, clip, and Dylan said, turn that blankety-blankety thing off. And that was the beginning of Allen's singing career. We went into a side room, and we hung out all night, and it was kind of wonderful because I thought, what a great thing that a wonderful songwriter like Dylan, who loved all kinds of music and also loved poetry and literature and painting and art, could transcend the role of being a songwriter, which in the Eastern Seaboard establishment snob appeal meant you were some kind of a low-class person because you were only writing short 32-bar songs. Maybe by working with a poet, the songwriter could transcend that prison that they were placed into and be considered also be a poet. Conversely, a poet didn't have to be a prisoner of the university or the poetry death scene. They could go out and sing their work. And as someone who played jazz and was a classical composer, I could play with people who played three chords and learn a lot from them and even improve my literary skills and up my IQ by hanging out with people who were more literate than I was. So after that evening, about a few weeks later, sure enough, we went into studios November 9th. There's a wonderful picture on the web of all of us with Allen Ginsberg's Nightmare Band all playing music together. It was really fun, and over the period of years, every time Allen ran out of money, he would call me up, and I'd go and play all the instruments that were available to help him finish up his recordings. Hal Wilder, who deserves a sainthood, got all of those tapes, cleaned them up, took out all of the extraneous stuff. When Gregory Corso came to one of the recordings, took a toy lawnmower and was screaming and yelling and cursing at Allen. It would have been interesting to have that historically, but it didn't help out the record. And he got all that stuff out, and Allen kept getting better and better and better. And after working with Steve Taylor for 20 years, he really sounded terrific. He loved music, he loved to sing, he loved to play the finger cymbals. And I think he was almost at his happiest when he was just sitting there singing. So when I went to Chengdu, China, after Allen passed away, and people were talking about him and his love of Buddhism and his love of spirituality, I kept wondering what I could do. And someone said, why don't you make up one of those crazy songs and get people to sing something in Chinese, in Mandarin? And I said, well, I don't know anything about Buddhism, so I can only address myself to appreciating Asian culture. And sure enough, the very last night I was there, I looked out the window, and someone was riding by on a bicycle, two people on a bicycle, this woman who couldn't see me looked up. I saw these incredible eyes, and was positive I saw someone from a previous life. So I wrote a little something down, then I took my instrument from Chengdu, China, which I brought with me, and made up a little piece, which I'd like to do. And then I have, it ends up with a little sing-along, where I'm going to ask all of you to sing along in Mandarin. The words are, Wa Hong Gao Shi Lai Dao Crosby Street. I am happy to be in Crosby Street. Wa Hong Gao Shi Lai Dao Crosby Street. Wa Hong Gao. We don't want to over rehearse. And I'd like to invite a wonderful young man who's going to play the glockenspiel. And you can have a, you can imagine that there's a piano here. This would be the ESP fantasy piano. Huh. And he's going to play some percussion. And we're going to do it the first and last time with a guitar and some other instruments. Please welcome Kevin Twigg. Ethnofunkology, this is a wonderful Chinese instrument called the hulusai, and it's used in Asian music. It's a wonderful, wonderful kind of sound. And especially for all you young people who are or would like to be poets, musicians, singers, dancers, writers, food thinkers, anything that you want to do with your career counselor is telling you can't possibly do. Just hang out with people who say, yes, let me see what you're doing and see what you can do. Allen and Gregory spend more time with people looking at their stuff, looking at their material, and giving them free lessons. Everything that I learned in my 82 years has been from people. Everybody from Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie to Sir James Galway, whom I wrote a flute concerto for, showing me what I didn't know because also I was eager to learn. So the best university of all is the University of Hangoutology. And to be the people who know more than you do and respectfully ask them what to do. And then when you learn something, do the same thing when someone asks you, because that's our obligation and that's what we're here for. All the elitism of snobism, prima donna, desire to be Superman and Superwoman is part of our culture. We can't change that. But that's a whole different field. I always tell kids being narcissistic, egomaniacal, selfish, disrespectful, creepy, is an overcrowded field in a non-growth industry. That's the way Allen was, and that's the way all of us come. So, remain beatific. Play first the hulusai, then the little poem called My Buddha Angel in Chengdu, followed by the sing-along men. changing China. I can't sleep awake. Staring out the window, water drips on dishes in the sink. A bike goes by. A young gal sits side saddle on the back, looks like Buddha's angel daughter, sent from heaven, dressed in black. She glances up. Her dark eyes make the morning come to life. Suddenly I realize long ago this angel was my wife. Wanted now to tell her when we married many years ago that I never would have left her if I knew now what I know. Wanted for what seemed a thousand years to see those eyes again. Sorry. Hoping someday I could tell her that our love would never end. Never dared to tell her then because of all the love we shared. It was more than I could handle, even though I really cared. Now it's many lifetimes later here in Chengdu, 5 a.m. My favorite wife from an earlier life, the sweetest one of all of them. Once she told me in our lifetime our true love would never die, and that even if I left her, Buddha's angel still would fly. Now she tells me broken hearts will all heal themselves in time, and that all the pain I caused her now is gone, except for mine. Now in Chengdu, through the window, she's come back to me again, riding in the back seat of her bicycle, side saddled with her friend. Guess since she's passed me by, there's only one thing I can do, get myself a new gal, a bicycle that's built for two. When in this reincarnation, when I found myself a brand new bride, maybe I'll find out as Buddha's angel riding by my side, telling me wherever we have been and through whichever life, through all our reincarnations, she's always been my wife. Now it's 7 in the morning, Chengdu streets are filled with light. I'm still staring out the window as the day is growing bright. Waiting by the window, need to see my true love's eyes again when she rides by on her bicycle, side saddled with her friend. Then I'll tell her that I love her. But this time, I know what to do. Waiting by the window for my Buddha angel in Chengdu. Well, a few years ago, I went down to Chengdu, China. Things could not have been finer. Learned a few words in Mandarin. Just say chin. Well, thank you, just say she or she, and that's all you gotta know. Then China, that's all, it's the hippest place to go. Well, here we are in New York City on Crosby Street on a beautiful night, honoring our old friend Allen Ginsberg out of sight. We want all of you to sing along because we've only got 2 minutes left on this song. Allen was always punctual, he never made his sets too long. So to accommodate Bob Rosenthal and the idea of punctuality, the 12 more bars will all be stars and sing in harmony. Now the sopranos and the altos and tenors and the basses, lift your faces, let's all see if we can sing along. The lyrics are simple, I'm glad to say the song is not too long. So now, we're going to sing take 2 of Buhong Gao Shi Lai Lai Crosby Street. And we can do it harmoniously, don't you know? You can tap your fingers and your feet. Here we go now. Shwang, Shee, lie down. Cross the sea. And lay in, lay. Mr. Kevin Twigg played two courses of the blues on his heavenly glockenspiel, not his xylophone. Because he could prove it's not what you feel, it's what you glockenspiel. Get him, Kevin.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Bookstore, for keeping literature alive in New York City.